Welcome back to Fundamentals of Conflict Resolution and Peacebuilding. This week, like last, and next week, I'm going to be focused on fundamental skills. You can use these skills, you know, as we are exploring the arts and humanities, that's foundational to conflict resolution and peacebuilding. And you must use these skills with multicultural interfaith democracy building. You know, think of the levels that I introduced to you earlier, and it will make sense to you. Today, I would like to start with what I had promised earlier, talking more about interest identification. Holding these truths, if you're working with that book, is walking you through activity after activity where you're asked to identify different party interests. It's so powerful in collaborative conflict resolution and peace building that I would say it's one of the top skills. It certainly can help you divert and de-escalate violence. I can tell you that from a lifetime of experience. There has been field tested research on optimal negotiation, along with the computer-generated games theory that I introduced to you last week. Neil Rackham is an example of such research that I often refer to. He was studying labor management negotiations that satisfied all the parties and sustained itself, didn't fall apart after the agreement. And what he found is the best negotiators zealously seek and identify common ground. Common ground is another phrase to describe shared interests. So if you have two parties to a conflict and you have identified the interests of each party, the shared interests are the interests that overlap. It's a very powerful way to help bring parties together and orient them towards peace building. Morton Deutsch was the psychologist who initially discovered the power of what he called cross ties. And Morton Deutsch was a psychologist at Yale who was studying racial conflict at a time, well, when have we not had a time, but it's post-Civil War. I would say around the time of that the civil rights movement was birthed in this country. So a segregated time. We still are facing and experiencing ugly, extreme racial conflict, but let's focus on the positive of what we can do as conflict resolvers and peace builders. He discovered that if parties, black and white, that's he was focused on African American and white Americans, Caucasian Americans, if they discovered that they had cross ties that would help them, both parties, better achieve their goals. So they were better off working together, the racial conflict decreased. Now, I grew up in a segregated time with black neighbors and friends in my neighborhood, and I was not allowed to attend our elementary school across the street from where we lived together until sixth grade. But my experience is growing up together and knowing each other, playing together as friends, is more powerful than discovering cross ties and shared goals. So I had no need, you know, to come up with a way my self-interest would be served by having African-American friends. I simply knew that my life was enhanced by our friendship. And so maybe this is a second tier, But when I work with people who have not grown up together, or their relationship has fallen apart, think, you know, husband and wives, landlord-tenant, it's just become very ugly and conflicted. Those types of conflicts, when people discover that they have something in common and that they will benefit from working together, the mood in the room changes completely. There's an initial moment of shock. I can't believe that I actually would benefit from working with this person who I hate. That's truly what goes on. And so you can see it's so important to learn how to help people do this. You know, we have to learn to see our similarities as well as our differences. And I love living in a multicultural interfaith city. I live in Long Beach, and it is one of the most diverse cities of its size in the country. And it's my preference. I was not happy living in Malibu or Santa Monica in the, you know, so-called white privileged parts of LA. I hungered and sought the diversity that helped me feel most alive. And I ended up moving over close to Culver City in the Palms neighborhood, close to Venice, and felt much more at home. Still, LA is what LA is, and I just was so happy when I found Long Beach. I live in the neighborhood that is closer to Carson and Dominguez Hills, the historically black side of Long Beach. I have absolutely no interest in living in white suburbia. I could do a whole course critiquing white suburbia in the United States. We all need to figure out how we're going to do this. Because I live in Long Beach, I don't know if you know that our mayor, a gay man from Peru originally, was one of the leaders and the role models in taking on the COVID pandemic. Long Beach was a model for the rest of the country in how he led us. I mean, it's a case study in many ways for the value of multicultural and interfaith living. Another example that I have some personal pride in, many of my former students live and work in Long Beach, and they are helping to prevent the urban violence that has escalated and increased in most other parts of LA County. And I could introduce you to some of them and what they're doing to help prevent and de-escalate city violence there. So anyways, we have to get in the habit of looking for our similarities as well as our differences. It helps to get to know each other as human beings. Now, Rackham's research also found that the best negotiators zealously seek to create options that benefit everyone. So they're not interested in win-lose. We don't see a lot of this negotiation. We see the win-lose, you know, the football, the baseball game, where winner takes all. That's the model that we tend to see. Now, parents of several children need to learn how to do ideas that benefit all. My parents were pretty good at figuring out how to treat us all as unique individuals and encourage, you know, who we are, but be very fair in dividing the pie of whatever was being split in the family, right? That's a way to get experience with all of this. Creating collaborative questions that ask, how can we? how can we all benefit? How can we do, fill in the blank, right? This will help you with skilled conflict resolution and peace building. And you can use the interests of people. So if someone has an interest in staying safe, while someone else has an interest in, advancing their business, you can ask, how can we ensure that this party stays safe while this party advances their business? So you just fill in the blanks with the party interests, and that will stimulate a lot of ideas, win-win ideas. Yeah, I'm giving you some other examples of how to do this. Oftentimes we want to do it in the most cost-efficient, affordable way. Play around with possibilities. And you know, this is a fundamentals of conflict resolution and peace building class, where those of you who love the arts get to do what you love to do with dance and performance and music and song and writing and all the, you know, painting, creative possibilities. So we can play here. Playing here and creative play is welcomed and encouraged. The best negotiators fuel all of this by asking 2 to 3 times more questions than the mediocre poor negotiator. So they're curious. And you know, think of you as a child, think of children, very curious about the world. We want to follow their example here as we play with possibilities. I think that's enough from me for now on interest identification. I'll see you in a minute.